The President of the United States is often given the title as the most powerful person in the world, but how powerful are they really? As Commander-in-Chief of the most advanced military in the history of mankind, they obviously hold a lot of power. But governments exist to pass laws, and the President often seems unable to get his way. So how much power does the President really have over lawmaking, and has this changed over time? In 1954, two mathematicians designed an ingenious way to measure the power of an individual in any yes-no voting system. It works by simply counting the proportion of times a person's vote changes the outcome from a losing position to a winning position. So let's begin with an example of a simple voting system. A very small country has a tiny parliament with just four members. We'll call them A, B, C, and D. To pass a law, it must gain a majority of three votes. So we can start by considering one sequence, A, B, C, D. A casts his vote first, and with just one vote, the law doesn't pass. B casts her vote next, still not a majority. Then C casts her vote in support and the law is passed. Therefore, C is the winning vote. In this case, D does not matter. If we list all possible sequences, the power of an individual is the proportion of times in which her vote changes the outcome. In our small parliament, there are a total of 24 possible sequences, and C is the deciding vote 6 times. So in a 4-person parliament, each person has a quarter of the power. This is not surprising, it's a very simple system. But this method allows us to work with much more complex systems and see how changing a system can change the balance of power. Let's move back to America. The American government is made up of two houses, the House of Representatives and the Senate. A bill must pass both houses with a simple majority and be ratified by the president. If the president refuses to ratify, they are vetoing the legislation. But the Congress can overcome a veto if both houses support the bill with a 2/3 majority. Since this system is already pretty complex, we'll start with a smaller Congress, with just 7 members in each house and 1 president. It's no longer possible to list all possible sequences. There are over 1.3 trillion. However, we can still see when the president has the deciding vote. If the president votes early in the sequence, either a senator or representative will be the deciding vote when the second house reaches a majority. If the president votes late, the 2/3 majority will cast the deciding vote. But there is a small window of opportunity when both houses are above a simple majority and below a 2/3 majority, where the president can be the deciding vote. In this sequence, there are 2 positions. So of the approximately 1.3 trillion sequences, the president casts a deciding vote just over 97 billion times. So the president holds about 7.5% of the power. Each congressman casts a deciding vote about 6.5% of the time. So in this tiny Congress, the president holds more power than individual congressmen. But together, the Congress holds the vast majority of power with 92%. So what about the real United States Congress? As you can imagine, this is where things get a bit more complicated. With just 14 congressmen, we had 1.3 trillion sequences. The real Congress is made up of 535 congressmen, which creates more sequences than microseconds since the Big Bang. However, we can take a smaller and random sample of these sequences to estimate the power of the president and Congress. When estimated in this way, the president has the deciding vote about 16% of the time, which means that the real Congress accounts for about 84% of the power. This looks like the president is not very powerful, but remember that there is just one president and 535 congressmen. So the president is actually 173 times more powerful than a representative, and 37 times more powerful than a senator. There's a reason the presidency is so sought after. But we know that over time, the Congress has actually gotten larger. So how has power shifted over time? Now, the rules for the Senate were set in the Constitution, 2 seats for each state. So by adding states to the Union, the power of the senators has reduced by 3/4 in the last 200 years, as their power has been diluted between more people. The rules for Congress are much less strict and have been the scene of many a 19th century fight. Over time, representatives fought to keep their seats during periods of massive population change. They generally compromised by increasing the size of the House. So whilst they cheated the system to keep their seats, they were seemingly unaware that this slowly eroded their power to 1/4 of its original force. During the same period of time, the president's power has remained relatively stable. Now, it seems that individual congressmen have little real power. What can they do to increase their influence? Well, the answer is to work together to vote in blocks. Next, we will see how coalitions work to increase their influence. This is something that the American Congress is particularly bad at, but is common practice throughout much of the world.